Hello, I'm Roberto Parisella, and I'm going to present Efficient Musics for Algebraic Sets. This is a joint work with Geoffroy Couteau, Helger Lippmann, and Arne Tobias Odegaard. A language L associated to a relation R is defined by the set of statement axes for which there exists a witness such that the pair statement witness is in the relation. Element in the language would be called as true statement, element not in the language would be called as false statement. An interactive zero knowledge proof is a protocol engaged by two parties. One of them, the prover, as an input a pair statement witness, has to convince the other, the verifier, that he has the witness without revealing any additional information. The parties exchange interaction, and the verifier, at the end, having an input to statement, and the whole set of messages, which is also called proof, has to output accept or reject. And it output accept if it convinces that the verifier knows the witness. We require those protocol to enjoy the following three properties. They has to be complete, which means that honest prover always convinces the verifier. They has to be sound, which means that malicious prover cannot convince the verifier. Particularly, it should be infeasible to make the verifier accept for any false statement. And they have to be zero knowledge, in the sense that at the end of the interaction, the verifier cannot learn anything about witness. We are also interactive in non-interactive zero knowledge proof, which are a particular kind of zero knowledge proof that consists only in one message sent by the prover to the verifier, which has only to output accept or reject. We are interested in a non-interactive zero knowledge proof, which we shortly called NISIX. Not only because verification is possible even when the prover is offline, but also because they are used in many applications and they are used as a primitive to build more complex cryptographic tools. However, in order to define a NISIC, we must suppose the existence of a trusted third party that computes and make available to both prover and verifier a common reference string or shortly CRS. For instance, this CRS can be the description of a hash function or an element from some distributions, or as in our case, an element sample from the uniform distribution over a cryptographic group. And the existence of this trusted third party is necessary in order to define NISICs, which are sort of sound and complete. Let's move on with an overview of the existing NISICs construction and let's compare them in terms of efficiency, expressivity, and security. And at the end, I also compare our new NISIC construction to show how it performs compared to the other. The first NISIC construction is due to Fiat and Shamir. And their core idea is a compiler that defines a NISIC from a particular class of three-round public coin interactive proof of knowledge, which is called Sigma protocols. Their compiler uses cryptographic hash functions. So those NISICs have all the advantages of the underlying Sigma protocol, which means that they perform very well in terms of efficiency and expressivity. In fact, for many applications, they are still the most efficient NISICs we have, and they are defined for all NLP languages. However, their security is defined only in the random oracle model, where we model the cryptographic hash function as a truly random oracle. It took quite a while before Groot and Sahai were able to define NISICs from standard, well-established cryptographic assumptions. Those NISICs were an outstanding result. However, they have some limitation, which makes them sometimes impossible to be used in practice. First of all, they are often just not efficient enough. And then they are defined only for pairing product equation, which means that in order to define a Groot Sahai NISIC for a specific application, one must first find a representation of a given problem as a set of pairing product equation, which sometimes is a very hard task. Lastly, recently, Couteau and Hartmann developed a new framework for defining NISICs. Their idea is a compiler that has for feature mean transform defined ESIX from Sigma protocol. However, their compiler only works for one specific Sigma protocol. So even though those ESIX have some very appealing features, such as efficiency comparable to feature-mean transform for some application, they also have some critical limitations. For instance, they are defined only for algebraic languages, which is a very restricted class of languages. Moreover, their assumption is based on a novel X-KNDH assumption, which can be a problem because it was a novel assumption, and maybe it was also not enough motivated in the original paper. Finally, with our NESIC, we built on top of CH framework, and we overcome their main limitations. So we define NESIC that performs slightly better than CH NESIC for most of the application. But more important, our NESICs are defined for algebraic sets, which are, I would say, a wide expressive class of languages. And also it relies on CAD assumption, which is a weaker version of the X-KNDH assumption that I will define later. So in the rest of this presentation, now that I give you a motivation on why our result is needed, I move on to present our result in detail. Let's first start with some notation. I use bracket notation so I actually assumed in this pairing that in this paper that we are using type 3 pairings, which means that we suppose no efficient isomorphism exists between group 1 and group 2. We use bracket notation, so x in bracket is the exponentiation of x with respect to a fixed generator. This big circle is indicated for the pairing operation. We indicate vector with this arrow, and we indicate matrices with upper letters with no arrows. We also need some preliminaries from Couteau and Dartman paper. As said before, their idea is to take a compiler that defines an ESIC from one specific Sigma protocol. Here in figure, I just sketched some of the peculiarities of the Sigma protocol, which are required in order to understand how their compiler works. So the statement and the first message are vectors of group elements, the witness and the third message are vectors of filed elements, and the challenge is one single filed element. And the verification equation is linear. The core idea of CH20 is taking the challenge, embed it in group 2, and publish it once and for all in the CRS. So now the prover will compute the first message as before, and intuitively, since it has the challenge only in group 2, it cannot exploit this knowledge in order to cheat. Then it will compute the third message directly in group 2, and it will send the proof all in one message to the verifier, which now performs the same verification equation, but using pairings. And as I mentioned before, this NESIC is solved under the novel X-KNDH assumption. So those NESICs enjoy some very appealing features. I would say that most of all, they have some very efficient NESIC for specific applications with efficiency comparison to Fiat-Shamil NESIC. However, they have some critical limitations. The first issue arises with the assumption. So first of all, the X-KNDH assumption is not always a falsifiable assumption. Basically, they have falsifiable X-KNDH only for all of linear languages. And then, the assumption is not studied enough. Actually, Couteau and Dartman just pointed out the assumption is trivially secure in GGM. But most important, Those basics are limited to algebraic languages, which are in principle not as expressive as Bayes' product equation. And as Bayes' product equation, to find the representation of a given problem as an algebraic language is an arduous task which requires several hours of work from a dedicated expertise. It would be much more desirable to have a framework to define an ISIC directly and automatically from an high level description of a given application. With our work, we overcome those limitations. First of all, our main idea is to define a different novel Sigma protocol and then apply the CH compiler to the Sigma protocol in order to define a new ISIC. Actually, the Sigma protocol is not explicitly defined in the conference version of the paper, but the Sigma protocol can be found in the full version of the paper. In the conference version, we define directly the ISIC resulting from CH compilation. So the reason why we were able to overcome the previous limitation was the following. First of all, we relied on a CAD assumption, which is a weaker flavor of the X-CanMDH assumption. Here we use weaker in the sense that stronger conditions are required for the adversary in order to win the underlying security game. Using the CAD assumption, we were able to show that more cases are based on falsifiable CAD. And also, even in the general case where CAD is non-falsifiable, we were able to reduce CAD to a single and very plausible gap assumption. But more important, instead of algebraic languages, our Sigma protocol and to our ISIC relies on algebraic sets. Algebraic sets are well studied in classical algebra, and we know many properties, and we can, and in fact, we use this property in our paper in order to define ISIC for a wide class of languages and applications. One important property is that it is possible to reduce circuit satisfiability to membership of some algebraic sets efficiently, as we pointed out in the paper. But more important, maybe, using algebraic set, we are able to define directly and almost automatic an ISIC from a very high level description of a given problem. Let's now define formally how our languages are defined. So first we pick a finite set of polynomials over a finite file. An algebraic set is the set of x's such that f of x is equal to zero for each f that are part of the set of the polynomial we have chosen before. Then we choose a public key linearly homomorphic encryption scheme. And the language is defined by the algebraic set and the encryption scheme as an encryption of an X that is in the algebraic set. So an element in the language would be an encryption of a common root of a given public set of finite polynomials. As I said before, our main contribution is a framework to define directly an ISIC from a very high level description of a given application. So let's start with the first point of this framework, the first task of this framework, which is find a good basis for the algebraic set. An algebraic set can be seen as an ideal in a polynomial ring. So from classical algebra, we know that many algorithms are known to find basis of ideal in the polynomial ring. We have to run one of those algorithms only once to find a good basis of the algebraic sets. We point out that this is a non-cryptographic problem and this is not solved, but we have methods to find a solution that is efficient enough for many interesting applications. Digging into this problem is beyond the scope of this paper. So the language is defined by encryption, as I said before, encryption of element axis, such that f of x is equal to zero for each polynomial that form the basis of a given algebraic set. The second step is now to define an ISIC given a base of an algebraic set. To completely and almost automatically solve this second point is our main technical contribution. And this is what I will explain now in this presentation. For the sake of clarity, throughout the rest of the presentation, I just stick with the simplest case of algebraic set generated by one single polynomial. The generalization will just be trivial and can be found in the paper. So we choose to use Elgamalov's lean encryption scheme, but actually any public key linearly homomorphic encryption scheme suffice in order to instantiate our music. We use those two because with Elgamalov we have the best efficiency, and with the lean encryption scheme we have some music with some properties that we'll present later. In order to define a music, we have to solve three steps separately. The first one is to define a possibly small affine matrix C of X, such that the determinant of C of X is equal to the given polynomial F of X, with some properties on top of that. The second step is to define an efficient sigma protocol to show that the determinant of C of X is equal to zero, given an encryption of X. And the third step is to use CH compiler to define a ISIC. As I said before, the second step is not explicitly defined in this paper, but the interested reader can find the sigma protocol in the full version of the paper. So to explain the first point, how to define this matrix C of X, let's start with the definition of quasi-determinant representation. A given matrix is a quasi-determinant representation, or short QDR, of a given polynomial F if it enjoys the following property. First, each entry is an affine map of the given X. Then the determinant C of X is equal to F of X. And note that those two properties define the well-known notion of matrices in determinant representation of a given polynomial. But on top of that, we require this third property. If we say that the first column of C is H and the rest of the matrix is T, we require this first column dependence. So for each X that is actually a root of F, we require that H of X is in the span of the other columns of the matrix, of course, evaluated in the given X. An intuition why those properties are needed in order to define our ISIC. The matrix has to be affine because the verifier will only have an encryption of X, and it has to homomorphically compute an encryption of C of X given the encryption of X. The properties that the determinant of C of X is equal to F of X is needed in order to guarantee soundness. Roughly speaking, if X is a false statement, then F of X is not equal to zero, which by this property means C of X is full rank, which means that we are able to break the underlying Kern-BH-based assumption. And finally, the third property, the first column dependence, is a technical detail needed in order to ensure that the honest prover is efficient. Okay, so far, another viewer could actually think that find a QDR matrix could be just a task as hard as finding an algebraic representation or a parent product equation representation. Even worse, if it is known that many interesting polynomial with determinant representation, maybe this result doesn't carry out for the less general requirement for QDR form. We show that this is not the case, defining a QDR matrix directly from an algebraic branching program, or ABP. An ABP is a directed acyclic graph with two vertices, S and T, and the labeling function phi, such that phi assigns an affine function to each edges, and a polynomial f of x associated to the ABP is computed taking the sum over all the possible paths from S to T of the product of the label across the path. Here a simple example, so f of xy is a bivariate polynomial which is equal to x to the third plus ax plus b minus y squared. And we can see that x squared is the product over edges of the blue path, ax is the product of edges over the green path, b on the red path, and minus y squared on the black path. We are able to deterministically and efficiently define a QDR matrix from an ABP. As it was already known, we started from the adjacency matrix of the graph. We remove the column corresponding to the vertex F. We remove the row corresponding to the vertex T. And we have a matrix which is a determinantal form of the given polynomial. That is already known. Then, on top of that, we just noted that if we replace 0 with minus 1 on the lower diagonal, we have a matrix in QDR form. So, at the best of our knowledge, defining an easy directly and deterministically from a very simple representation of an ABP is a useful and good result, and different from previous construction of MISIX, doesn't require dedicated expertise. Now I can show in details how our MISIX is defined. So the language, the statement would be an encryption of a given element under randomness R, such that the determinant of C computed evaluated that element is equal to 0. And the witness would be the element key and the randomness R. The zero, as I said before, would be a uniformly random element in group 2. The prover will have statement witness and CRS. The verifier is only CRS and the statement, so the encryption. So the prover acts in the following way. First, it uses two algorithms to compute two vector gamma and theta. Gamma is computed using the description of C and only X as input. Delta is computed using as additional input some internal states and the challenge E. Then the proof will consist of gamma in group 1 and delta in group 2. And I point out again that the first column dependence that we require for our matrix, it is needed in order to ensure that those two algorithms are efficient. So particularly, this property ensures that the prover is able to efficiently compute gamma independently from E. Then gamma and the theta and delta has to verify the verification equation that we found here in the right bottom of the slide. So gamma plus C of X times E concatenated to delta must be equal to 0. And the verifier is just check this verification equation using Bayes. Of course, That was a mock version of our NISIC. Now we can see in the figure how the NISIC is actually defined. The real first message will be an encryption of gamma on freshly generated randomness. The real third message will be delta computed in group two, because the prover has the challenge E only in group two. Some auxiliary element Z, also computed in group two. And the verifier, instead of checking the plain verification equation, without going too much into details, just check an encrypted version of the verification equation using those element Z in order to annihilate randomizers. Soundness can be proved under the X KNBH assumption, which basically is an extension of the well-known external kernel matrix Diffie-Hellman assumption. As for the case of KNBH assumption, we received an input in group two, and we have to output a matrix in group one, such that the input is in the kernel of the matrix, and the matrix is of rank high enough. But in this case, we allow the adversary the power to extend the vector it receives as input. So this gamma in group two will actually be the extension of the input. And the adversary can extend this vector as long as for each element it added, it also outputs an additional element in group one. So as long as high enough number of vectors in group one are linearly independent, then in order to compute them, the adversary must have found non-trivial relation between input in group two and output in group one, and this should be R. And so we say that the adversary wins the game if it outputs this matrix gamma concatenated C, such that the extended vector D concatenated gamma is in its kernel, and the rank of this matrix in group one is high enough. In our case, is n. Why is this a fit for soundness? Well, because if x is a false statement, then c of x has rank n, and then the created version of the verification equation can be used to ensure that the adversary breaks the x KNBH assumption. But actually, we require a weaker condition in order to guarantee soundness, because we only require that the rank of C is equal to n. So previously, we say that the adversary wins if rank of gamma concatenated C is equal to n. While for soundness, it appears that the adversary wins only if rank of C is equal to n. Which means that we actually don't need the full power of the X KNBH assumption, but only a weaker version of it that is sufficient for soundness of our NISIC argument. And that's why we introduced the CAD assumptions. So here I just recall briefly that we are in type 3 pairings. So the game is the same as the game for the X KNBH. We sample the challenge, we give this vector in group two to the adversary. The adversary computed a matrix in group one and an extension of the input in group two. And the adversary wins the game if the extended vector is in the kernel of the matrix in group one and the rank of C is equal to one. Using the set assumption means that we can guarantee better security condition. First of all, more cases are basic and falsifiable CAD. Because basically every time we can check that given matrix C of X is full rank, given X as a group element, we have falsifiable CAD. For instance, every time F is a product of affine functions, we can efficiently check that F of X is equal to zero given X as a group element. And so those cases are always basic and falsifiable CAD. Another case is that the algebraic set itself as only a polynomial number of elements, which is, for instance, the case of univariate polynomials. So univariate algebraic sets generated by univariate polynomials are sound under 45 mm. And our needs for those set are sound under 45 CAD. In the general case where CAD is non-falsifiable, we were able to reduce it to a single plausible gap assumption. A gap assumption is an assumption of the following type. Say that a given problem is easy. This doesn't mean that another given problem is easy too. In our case, we use the following gap assumption. If CDH is easy in group one, it doesn't mean that KLMDH is also easy in group two. This is a very plausible assumption in depth tree pairings where exploiting some regularity in group one should not carry out in exploiting the same in group two. And lastly, slightly modifying our construction, we were able to show NESIC based on, to design a NESIC based on falsifiable CAD for each languages. Of course, this comes at the cost of efficiency. First of all, we have to use the less efficient DLL encryption scheme. And this is because the way we rely on falsifiable CAD is because we force the prover to output additional elements. And we check that f of x is equal to zero, given an arithmetic circuits of gate of degree two. That compute f of x, which means that we have to force the prover to output encryption of x in group two, and that's why we need the drill encryption schemes. So to show the goodness of our method, we have some applications, of course. So we have, to the best of our knowledge, the best NESIC for set membership in terms of efficiency of prover and verifier, and also communication complexity. We also have a very efficient NESIC to show that a point belongs to a given elliptic curve, which is an application needed for some scenarios in blockchains and cryptocurrencies. And we also have some very efficient NESIC for circuit satisfiability. To the best of our knowledge, those are the most efficient NESIC in the standard model for circuit satisfiability. As a side result, we also have a better representation of some algebraic languages with better, here I mean shorter than the previous state of art representation, which actually means we have better efficiency for primitive likes, smooth project hash functions. But also, we believe that one of the very good selling points of our paper is its generality and how easy it is to define efficient NESIC. So we hope that, as it was the case for group size NESIC, more application will come in the future. At the end, I have some concrete efficiency comparison. For example, in this case, we have numbers for set membership proof NESIC, where here we just embedded the set membership problem as a membership of an algebraic set generated by a univariate polynomial. So in the case of group size NESIC, we didn't add prover and verification complexity because numbers are not published, and they are based on our estimation, but we can see how we improve also in the sides of communication complexity. Maybe it's not easy to see at the first sight, but let's recall that usually elements in group two are twice as long as elements in group one. So here the first line is for optimizing group size proof for set membership. The second line is for previous state of art CH20 NESIC. The third line is using directly CH20 with our new algebraic languages construction. And finally, the third line is our NESIC. Another example, the comparison of Physics based on falsifiable assumption for Boolean circuit satisfiability. Here, for example, we can see that we save several elements, particularly in group two. First of all, let's point out that the commitment, which in this case is the statement, in the case of groups I, is to be given in both group one and group two, while in our case has to be given only in group one. So we actually just save a lot by that. And also the prover is more efficient. Also the computational complexity is way better. Thanks for your attention. And I hope you will find the paper interesting. And if you can also find for the full version of the print.